Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. We are still discussing thermodynamics, and today we are going to talk about a new concept, which is the concept of heat transfer mechanism. And heat transfer is, there are three types of mechanism for heat transfer. We have the first one, which is heat transfer by conduction. Okay, that's the first type of heat transfer mechanism. The other one is by convection. Okay, conduction, convection, and the third one will be by radiation. Okay, so there are three types of heat transfer. We're going to concentrate mainly on the conduction because of its applications. Okay, we talk a little bit about convection and radiation, but conduction is the most important mechanism among these three mechanisms of heat transfer. Conduction, actually, you need a hot reservoir here. We call it a hot reservoir, okay? And a cold reservoir on this side. This is a cold reservoir, okay? And you need a conducting medium, which will be generally, it's a metal, okay? Generally, it's a metal, because metals, they have good thermal conductivity. So this will be a temperature. This on the left will be a temperature T. I call TH because it's hot, so TH. And this one cold, we'll call it TC. I can give you an example. This could be, for example, water at 100 degrees C. And this is, let's say, ice at 0 degrees C. Okay, that's the, and if you connect them with this heat conducting medium, so this is the heat conducting medium, the heat conducting medium. So that's the medium. This medium is just to conduct heat. It will not, okay, heat conducting medium, Okay, we assume also that this heat conducting medium is insulated, okay? So heat cannot go from the sides. It has to go, of course, you should know that the heat goes from hot reservoir to the cold reservoir. So the heat will flow in this direction, okay? Heat will flow in this direction, okay? That's Q. We are interested in something called the rate of heat transfer, the rate. It's called the rate of heat transfer, okay? Of course, I'm sure in your daily life, you have already experienced the heat conduction. If you have a spoon which is in a hot plate, if you touch it, you feel the heat at the end of the spoon. That's the heat transfer. The heat is transferred from one side of the spoon to the other side. So this is the medium that we are talking about, okay? So the rate, whenever we talk about rate in physics, it means it's you deal over time, okay? So the rate of heat transfer, so it's Q over T. And we call this P conduction, okay? We call it a P, it has units of power, as you can see, it's joule over seconds. We call it P conduction, okay? The rate of heat transfer, P conduction. So let's see, okay? This is the area, that's the area, the cross-section area of my material here, the cross-section area. Of course, it is uniform. It has a uniform shape. And this is the length of the material. It's important. And we have what is called the thermal conductivity, K, of the material. So what do you expect this? What are the variables that will affect the heat transfer or the rate of heat transfer, let's say? Of course, the material, the type of material is important. That's the K, which is called the thermal conductivity. Okay, so if you have this is the cross-section area, okay, that's the A. If you have a bigger cross-section area, you expect the heat transfer to be, the rate of heat transfer to be more. So you expect the A to be in the numerator here, in the numerator, okay? Now, how about the length of my medium, this rod here? As the length becomes more, you have less heat conduction, okay? So you expect the L to be in the denominator like this, okay? Then if of course, the temperature difference here is important. If this is too high and this is too low, the heat transfer will be more. If this is, these two temperatures are close to each other, temperature, the heat transfer will be less. If they are at the same temperature, there will be no heat transfer at all, okay? So you expect TH minus TC to be here, okay? And that's, we call this the rate of heat transfer by conduction, okay? So we have the material here, K, the thermal conductivity, okay? We call K, this K here, is called the thermal conductivity, and it depends on the material, okay? It depends on the material. Let me give you an example of thermal conductivity of copper, for example. Copper is a good conductor. Its thermal conductivity is actually 401 with the units, okay? With the units, with the proper units, which is watt. This is watt. This is K, watt over meter Kelvin, okay? That's the units for thermal conductivity. The thermal conductivity of air is about 0.2, I think. Is it 0.02, okay? So 0.02, it means watt per meter Kelvin, okay? 401, it means high, okay? If you have a good thermal conductivity, the peak conduction will be higher. And if you have a low thermal conductivity, the peak conduction will be less. So it depends on your applications. If you want to isolate the heat transfer, you want to isolate, you put a material here which has a low thermal conductivity. If you want a high rate of heat transfer, you put a material which has high thermal conductivity. So this is the idea of thermal conductivity. You can also have the case where you have two materials. Sometimes people use two materials, okay? That's the applications, okay? If you have two materials, I'm talking about conduction here. Let me go to this side here because this is related to conduction. If you have two materials, okay, one has K1 and the other one has K2, and you have also the hot reservoir here, TH, and the cold reservoir here, TC, okay? We talk about something called it's called the steady state, okay? The steady state. Of course, the heat conduction will be in this direction, okay? When you reach what is called the steady state, at the steady state, the heat conduction, in the beginning, the heat conduction here and here are not the same. It's very important to understand at this point. Once you reach a temperature here, we call TX, at the junction of the two materials, once the temperature becomes fixed, doesn't change, then you have what is called the steady state. At this moment, peak conduction in material number one is equal to peak conduction in material number two, okay? Sometimes you need to put two different materials depending on your application. Sometimes you put three materials depending on your applications, okay? So we can find, so peak conduction, we can find TX, by the way. So I can write K1, okay, I'm going to use this equation. I assume that the cross section area of the two materials is the same. So this will be TH minus TX over L, the length of the first material. And I'm going to assume that the area and the length are the same for both materials. So assuming, okay, so this is L and this is L, okay? And this is cross section area is A, and the cross section area here is also A. And here it is also A, okay? The cross-section area, okay? So this is equal to K2A TX minus TC over L. I'm sure you know that TX is going to be between TH and TC. I hope you know that, huh? So this is always positive. Here you put TH minus TX, and here is TX minus TC. Everything is positive here. You can find from this one here, you can find TX. You can find TX, and there are many problems in the exams where they ask you about TX. They ask you about the temperature in the junction, at the junction in the steady state. Otherwise, you cannot find it because it's changing. So once it is fixed, then you can do that, okay? When you fix the temperature, when you have the steady state, you have fixed temperature. So you can find TX, and then take the value of TX here and put it in one of the equations to find the peak conduction in this case, okay? The peak conduction here and here are the same. We put that condition in the steady state. You get you get the area TH minus TC over L over K1 plus L over K2. We call this the thermal resistance, okay? R. This is R. It's called the thermal resistance, okay? Resistance. Because you will see later the electrical resistance also, later when you do electricity. So this is called, we call R1, and this is called HR2. So you can write this in a compact way. You say A T H minus T C over R1 plus R2. What happens if you have more than one layer, okay? You have more than one layer. What will happen in this case? You have 2, 3, 4 N layers. So in general, let's write a general formula for this case, P conduction, okay? In general, let me write down here. In general, general means you have what? You have more than two. You have 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on. In general, P conduction will be what? Will be the area, the cross-section area of your... of course, you have to assume that all of them, they have the same cross-section area, okay? TH, which is the temperature of the hot reservoir, minus TC, temperature of the cold reservoir, over sigma RN, where N is equal 1 to... where N is RN, 1 to the number of... Okay? Let me write it down in another way, okay? I'm going to write RI here, and I will go to from 1 to N, okay? RI, where I goes from 1 to N, where N is the number of layers you have, okay? That's the thermal conductivity in one material. Here, when you have two materials, this is P conduction here. This is the formula for it, you see? And then when you have many materials, 3, 4, 5, whatever, this is the conduction, the rate of heat transfer by conduction, okay? Of course, you have to understand that this is the units of this is what, okay? Because it is joules over second from the definition. It's joule over second. We will later we will solve some problems related to this heat transfer by conduction. Now let's go to the convection. Convection. There is no formula here to show. It's just I'm going to just explain to you conduction or convection. What is it? Imagine now. Of course, convection is happening everywhere. Okay. Let me give an example. Imagine you have water here. Okay. Water and you have a flame here, a flame, okay? The flame, of course, the flame has a many. It has a blue also. Sometimes when the flame is too hot, it turns to blue. Blue is hotter than red, by the way. Yeah, okay. So this is the flame here. So you have a flame from whatever a stove or whatever, and the water is here. Okay, so you have the water here, and you should know that this part of the water will heat before this part, okay? So this is hot somehow, and this is cold somehow, okay? So when the water, by the way, this applies not only to water, any fluid, it's air also in the room. When you are heating the room, the same idea. And even in the atmosphere, the weather, how the weather changes, is that these are circulation of air, hot and cold air. That's why... That's how the changes in the weather. Okay, so the hot here, when the water, we're talking about water here. Okay, this is water. When the water becomes hot, it becomes less dense because it expands. Heat. We know that anything which is hot expands. Okay, so when it expands, it becomes less dense. So low density here. So low density. What happens when you have low density? The buoyant force will push this water upward. So this water here, the hot water, I'm going to put in red, will go upward. When the hot water goes upward, it pushes the cold water, which is more dense. It pushes down. Okay. So you have a circulation like this until the whole water becomes what? at equilibrium, I mean in thermal equilibrium, the same temperature everywhere. So this is the heat transfer by convection. It is through pushing the hot medium, air or water or any fluid, the hot part pushes the cold part and then also circulates. You see, this becomes, when it comes down, it becomes hot, it pushes the other side and so on. That's the convection in general, okay? The last one will be radiation, okay? Radiation is actually, these are electromagnetic waves, okay? Electromagnetic waves, okay? And they do not need medium. Do not need a medium to propagate. An example will be the light, okay? Light we receive from the radiation we receive from the sun. Do not need a medium, okay? That's what it is about radiation. Okay, there is what is called Stefan Law. This is a physicist. His name is Stefan. He derived, actually he wrote this law like this. It says E or P radiation, okay, P radiation is equal to sigma, a constant, Stefan Boltzmann constant, area of my radiating object, let's say the sun. This is epsilon, the emissivity, T to the power 4. And this is temperature. The temperature of your radiating object in Kelvin. In Kelvin, okay? Now, this is, of course, this constant. I can give you the value of the constant if you want. That constant is, I don't have it here, so it's not important. You can look at your textbook, okay? You can look at this constant. This is the area of your radiating object. That's the Stefan Boltzmann constant. The emissivity is between 0 and 1, okay? It is between 0 and 1, depending on if you have a black body or not. If your object is black body, then epsilon is 1, and T temperature in Kelvin. Actually, this formula here, or this equation, was used to estimate the temperature of the sun, okay? And the estimate of the temperature of the sun is about T sun is almost about 5,000 Kelvin. This, of course, is an estimate, okay, of the temperature of the sun. Of course, we are talking about the surface of the sun here, eh? Not inside. Inside is like a nuclear reactor inside. It's more, it's much higher than that. Eh? And actually, there is a convection inside the sun. In the core of the sun, the temperature is much higher, and it pushes, that's how it pushes the convection also happening inside the sun, okay? So let's, these are the three types of heat transfers. We talked about conduction, convection, and radiation. I hope this is clear. Now we go to solve some examples, which are problems from all the exams that are given in our department. I'm going to show you this experiment here, where we have five rods. One of them is made of glass, steel, brass, aluminum, and copper. And they are covered with wax, okay? And then I'm going to heat, they have the same length, you notice, they have the same length, all of them, the same cross-section area, and they are all going to have the same temperature on this side, and the same temperature on this side. This is the room temperature, and here inside I'm going to pass steam at 100 degrees Celsius. So this part will be 100 degrees Celsius, and this is room temperature for all of them. So if you go to this equation, delta T for all of them will be the same. They have the same length, same cross-section area, but they have different thermal conductivity. So I'm going to do the experiment now. I'm going to start now heating and see what happened to the wax. Okay? So he's going to bring now, going to heat. The water is going to start boiling here, and there will be steam coming through this here, this side. And so this will be at high temperature. That's the hot reservoir. This will be the cold temperature. That's the room temperature. That's the cold reservoir. And that's the difference in temperature between this side and this side is delta T. I said the cross-section area of these rods are the same. the length is the same, but they have different thermal conductivity. You can see now that the wax here on the copper have already melted, which means the heat conduction here is very high. So quickly, the time in a short time, because we have heat conduction here is higher, in a short time the wax melted, then aluminum come after that because it has so K of copper is the highest, then came the aluminum has lower than K than copper, but is higher than brass. You see the brass has not melted yet. You can see it now. It will start melting. You can see that the brass, then there will be the steel, and the glass will be the last one, because for glass K is about, I think, 1.2 or 2.1. It's low compared to K for copper, which is 401. Thank you.